you that you have not made us for darkness and for death, but for life with you forever. Without you, we have nothing to hope for, but with you, we have nothing to fear. So we ask that you would draw close to each one of us today, that you would speak to us your words of eternal life, that you would lift us from anxiety and grief to the light and the peace of your presence. We ask that you would set the glory of your love before us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to stand to sing our first hymn. It's "The Lord's My Shepherd."
Sitting on the floor in our navy blue shorts, but Neville Cross, the bandmaster of the Shirley Pipe Band, asked, "Which of you little lads would like to learn to play the bagpipes?" Well, not knowing any better, we put our hands up, and that was the start of our bagpipe playing that remained us, with the three of us, for over 50 years. However, for Martin, bagpiping was more than this. Martin was always looking for opportunities to network and promote his piping, particularly playing at those events close to his heart, like anything to do with sport and steam trains. He also had many different and sometimes unusual promotional ideas, from his tartan-clad car, and his many with his own picture on the bonnet, to Piper Parrot and Santa Piper for the youngsters, and even as recently as this Christmas Eve, when he was round at our house, walked in the house with an inflatable penguin, telling me his latest idea for Piper Penguin. But this was Martin. Passionate about whatever he did. Martin made bagpiping into his legacy and the person that we all remember. It all started with the Shirley Pipe Band, including some really memorable trips to France, Belgium, Germany, at various festivals. However, this led to much more when he started doing his own thing. I know a lot of pipers, but Martin achieved so much more, opened more doors, promoting himself, networking with so many contacts, achieving exposure across a wide, diverse client base, many of which became his friends. It's also no surprise that he encompassed his love for the pipes with his love of music and sport, particularly the world of motorsport. Piping for the rally driver Colin McRae for many years, plus also piping at the Formula One events for David Coulthard, Jensen Button, and he piped at football matches with football's prestigious PFA awards. And he loved piping for the international rugby league, particularly at Twickenham and Cardiff. And he loved playing for various celebrities and did this many times. And he particularly loved collecting the signed memorabilia from those celebrities as well. And he treasured those fantastically, both from the world of sport and the music industry. So his pipes truly opened many, many more doors for him, which his friend John Stevens has captured on film and camera many times, and we'll perhaps share some of these with you later on today when we go back to the reception. I have so many memories of my time with Martin. We went through scouts and school together, even our first job together, which was at Waitrose in Hall Green. We left school and we started working there. We'd all, actually I'm going up at live now. We actually went to get their job at Waitrose in Hall Green. And we both already got jobs to start in September for our apprenticeships. But we both went and got these jobs and sort of conned our way in there. That was what we were going to do. But we had a great time for a few weeks over the summer months. place now. We did all sorts of things together. Actually, one example was such that Martin, Robin and I, we used to go through the gate at the bottom of his garden. We used to play football for hours on the pitch behind his house. I think that used to belong to Sir Heat Transfer, actually, who I later started working for. We used to go and watch Birmingham City Football Club with his dad and his granddad. Working together in our first job at Waitrose, actually I've already mentioned this, and what we used to do, we used to mark down and buy the, I shouldn't really tell you this. We used to mark down and buy the damaged packets of Bonio biscuits from his dear dog, Rusty. We had holidays together, camping in Cornwall, visiting his sister Janet in Malta, snorkelling in the Blue Lagoon, and even on one evening arranged to go out with three pairs of girls on one evening and achieving it. That was typical of Martin. We had some fun times. He was always trying to fit more into the day. It's just how Martin lived his life. He loved his cars too, always taking great care of them, keeping them clean. In the early days, it was the Mini Cooper, which I used to navigate with him for treasure hunt rallies. However, it was sometimes a bit difficult in understanding his left from his right, which made it a bit difficult giving him directions, which wasn't really very ideal. Then he had his MGB. And of course, everyone knows, and it's very recognisable, Titan Club Ford Focus, and more recently, the Citroen C4. He was never one for wanting to miss an opportunity of networking or to promote his piping to please others. We spent many, many evenings out together. In the early days, it was in the pubs and clubs, like the Crown, Cinders, Snooty Fox, Scandals, Squires, etc. In those days, the regular pub we used to meet up with our friends was the Crown in Monkspat, now the Harvester. Where I remember one evening, Martin saying to me, "You see that guy over there? He's in here every night." So I said, "Hold on a second, that means if we see him in every night, that must mean we're in here every night." In the early 80s, before he moved into Warner's Drive, he even lived with Sue and I for a few months. So you can say he's been a part of our family for many years. Over the last 10 to 20 years, we've enjoyed spending time together going to watch various football matches, international rugby, Wales in Cardiff with Wayne and the guys, watching England at Twickenham, and of course he loved piping for the Scottish team too. Not always invited, I hasten to add, but we enjoyed doing it. Then there was the Cheltenham Gold Cup Week, plus various other music concerts together we used to go to. Jules Holland, Elkie Brooks, and particularly Paul Carrick. We loved going to see Paul Carrick. We saw him many, many times. He also loved having a nice meal, a few drinks and a chat, be it round at my house or out and about somewhere. We're with Mull over his latest projects, what his harebrained ideas were, and put the world to rights. You know, we loved doing all that. His other passion was steam trains. So we'd often take the opportunity to play his pipes for the Shakespeare Express, and I've accompanied him numerous times to railway memorabilia auctions too, having to hold his hand down so he doesn't bid for too many things. These are all our own special stories which we would frequently enjoy reminiscing together, and which I look forward to sharing with you in the future as well. We all reflect on perhaps not spending enough time with our loved ones, family or friends, so we must strive to enjoy whatever time we do have together, because these are the memories, like I'm sharing with you today, that we will cherish together. So just as I'm doing, I'm sure you'll be doing the same with your own memories of Martin. So to sum it up for me, Martin, he was passionate about everything he did, always striving hard to please others, a fun-loving, cheeky chap, the best friend.
Well, what can you say about Martin? Well, quite a lot, actually. I've known Martin since he and I were both 4 years old. And one of my earliest memories of Martin was of his riding a blue tricycle that he used to use to go to street school. And he thought he was Stirling Moss on this thing. And I was always led to believe that the tricycle had been designed so that all three wheels should remain in contact with the ground at all times. But Martin demonstrated that this was not always so. And occasionally, he'd offer you a lift on this tricycle, and you'd stand with your feet above the back axles Axel, hanging on precariously to his shoulders in front as he negotiated curbs, lampposts and pillars. It was quite a relief to get to Streetsfield School, and if you got back in one piece, that was an added bonus. As Mike said, we spent many, many hours playing football in what was a full-size goal on a football pitch that was behind Martin's house, practicing penalties, corner crosses. And I think that inspired in Martin his lifelong interest in football. And he always used to amaze me on a Saturday afternoon. He could recall accurately all the football results for all the clubs across all the league's divisions. Not just the large clubs such as Manchester United, Liverpool, Birmingham City, but also the smaller and lesser known clubs, Tranmere Rovers, Partick Thistle, Aston Villa. His chat-up lines with girls met in pubs and various discotheques, well, they were quite legendary. Some of them actually worked, but a fair percentage didn't. And I think he actually got to know A&E on a couple of occasions. As he got older, he became more philosophical, more serious to some extent. And if you called him on the telephone, he would tell you the latest situation with politics, the latest state of the economy, international relations between North Korea and China, and all this in response to the question, how are you? But Martin, one thing you can say, he was never, ever boring. He was a man of many interests, and as has been mentioned, he had a love of railways that was inspired by his brother Stephen early on. He became a collector of railway memorabilia, but he had interests across in motorsport, and as has been articulated by Mike, a love of bagpiping. I would sum him up as saying he was just tremendous fun, great fun to be with. You never knew what he was going to say. A lot of it was nonsense, quite frankly, but that was the fun of an evening out with him. But he had a wonderful sense of humour, and he would enthrall you with what I would describe as an infectious laughter. I would say he was one of life's great characters, and he will be very, very missed. Thank you.
Martin was one of three children born to his parents, Raymond and G. He leaves his brother, his sister Shannon, sadly passed on. He was always a devoted uncle to the wider family. His career was as a quantity surveyor, working in a variety of places, finishing up at Northampton County Council. But it is as a piper that most people will remember him. I know he used to be a fairly regular visitor here, piping for funerals when that was required on occasions. But I'd like to read you just one or two tributes that have been sent by people who knew him. This is from Jake Humphrey, who's the anchor man of BBC Sports Formula One from 2009 to 2012. I was really saddened to hear of Martin's passing. A man so full of life, passion and humour. It got to the point that he was the first person we looked for at many motor racing events. Most will immediately think of his bagpipes when they think of Martin. I think of a smile that would light up any room, and I know many figures from the motorsport world would agree. Rest in peace. And this is from Sir Jackie Stewart. Sir Jackie was sad to hear of the passing of Piper Major Martin Hewins. Sir Jackie has asked that deepest sympathy and sincere condolences be passed to Martin's brother, family, and of course to your son. The passing of one so young is naturally tragic for all concerned. And this is from Alison McRae. I'd like his family and friends to know that he was very highly thought of by Colin, myself and Colin's family. He would turn up at events and have a smile and time for everyone. Thank you, you are so kind. We are in the middle of another extremely windy and wet day. I hope it's better where you are. And you have a gentle day tomorrow, because Martin was such a gentle person. When we met to talk about today, we tried to think of words to describe Martin. Probably the best word we came up with was flamboyant, friendly, sincere, caring. Martin was someone who was greatly loved, and so will be greatly missed. Today we've come to remember him and to thank God for his life. We're going to sit and listen to The World in Union now. It's a good song to listen to and to remember Martin as we listen. Bible reading comes from chapter 14 of John's Gospel. Jesus said, "Set your troubled hearts at rest. Trust in God always. Trust also in me. There are many dwelling places in my Father's house. If it were not so, I should have told you. For I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I shall come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way I am taking. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. Peace is my parting gift to you, my own peace, such as the world cannot give. Set your troubled hearts at rest and banish your fears." If you're Martin's age, or my age, or thereabouts, and you went to Sunday school as a child, you probably grew up knowing that passage from the Bible. I certainly did. And he used to talk about mansions. So I thought that when I died and went to heaven, I was going to have a mansion for eternity. Mine was this big place with a big drive-in, I'm sure you get the picture. And I thought, God, that will be fine, thank you, a mansion for eternity. Then as I became an adult, there were more modern translations of the Bible. And I noticed that the word mansion had vanished from that passage, and it had been replaced by the word house. I tried to scale down my picture a little bit. But a house for eternity, well, that's okay, God, thank you very much. But as I reached middle age, there were more modern translations still. And this time, the word house has gone, and it's been replaced by the word room. So perhaps you can see how I was beginning to become a little concerned that over 50-odd years of life, I've gone from having a mansion for eternity to having a room for eternity. And that made me want to look at this passage a little bit deeper and say, what is it that Jesus was trying to say? The word that was translated mansion came from the Greek word amansio. And amansio was sort of like motorway services in first century Palestine. If you travelled anywhere, it was hot, it was dangerous, it was dirty. So amansio was a place you looked to get to at the end of the day's walk, because it was a place of comfort, a place of rest, a place of peace. So you see, when Jesus spoke these words, he didn't want us to think about mansions or houses or worry about how small the room might be. No, what he wanted us to know was something much more important than that. He wanted us to know that when we come to the end of this life, we don't have anything to be worried or concerned about, because he has somewhere prepared and ready for us. A place that's a bit like a mansion, a place of peace, a place of rest. As we remember Martin today, so we remember that that's where he is today. And so we trust him to God's love and to God's keeping. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for Martin and for his life. Thank you for the words that have been said about him today. And thank you for every treasured memory that we have of him. We thank you as well that you're looking after Martin today in a place where there's no more pain or suffering. Heavenly Father, help us today to be content to release him to you and to your keeping. Loving God, I want to pray a very special blessing on Martin's family at this time. And Lord, for all who grieve today, I pray that you would be a support and a strength, that through trusting in you, each one would find help and comfort today and in the days that lie ahead. We thank you again for Martin and for his life, and we commend him to your safe and eternal keeping as we pray in the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. I'd like to invite you to say the Lord's Prayer with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We're going to start to sing our second hymn. It's the day thou gavest, Lord, is ended. Could I ask you to please remain standing at the end of the hymn?
Thank you. Martin was in touch with her, so that's all right. Mm-hmm. Say she's going to be in the chapel.
I think you get to keep the cards and get them from me.
Yes,
she organised it.
Yeah.
We can have a chat about a few stories.
Reminiscing.
We can only talk about the clean ones.
I remember you mentioning that.
Oh, do you really?
Yeah.
Clive.
Yeah.
Oh, Clive. Yes, I do. I do remember you. You used to be a few doors down, didn't you? That's the screen.
No. We lived in
Hampton Arden.
But
I can remember you.
I never thought.
So it's been 2 years now, isn't it?
Well, it's coming up. It's not that long, actually, since
about 18 months.
She died in November.
We'll go and see her grave.
It's over there,
yeah.
Well, then,
go.
Chill
you.
We'll see you again soon,
then. We'll see you soon.
Play the one tune, okay, John?
Yeah, I'll do with that.
How was that, John?